Somewhere in these waters lies the answer to one of the world's most beguiling mysteries. In an area of sea that has claimed hundreds of lives. Over the last century, 1,000 ships have been reported lost without a trace in the Bermuda Triangle. Using state-of-the-art technology, we're going to unlock one of the ocean's deepest secrets. Can science prove if a recently discovered natural phenomenon could be dragging ships down to a watery grave? We will reopen the investigation into the Triangle's oldest myth, the doomed Flight 19, a routine mission interrupted, but by what? And we'll reveal a new mystery that until now was unexplained.
Holy cow.
Here, the truth can be far stranger than fiction. There are powerful, some would say evil, forces at work out here. Since 1492, when Columbus first sailed into the area and saw strange lights in the sky, the list of bizarre disappearances in the Bermuda Triangle has grown. Thousands of ships and planes have simply vanished without a trace. No warning, no distress calls, no wreckage. The Triangle covers the seas between Bermuda to Miami down to Puerto Rico. 1.5 million square miles of treacherous water. Hurricanes, intense storms and rough seas are the main killers out here. The weather can change from benign to deadly in a matter of minutes. But according to the Coast Guard, around 120 boats vanish each year without a trace. It is these unexplained disappearances that keep the mystery of the Bermuda Triangle alive. Richard Weiner has written many bestsellers about bizarre forces at work in the Triangle.
We don't know our own planet. We know more about the moon. We're probably learning more about Mars than we know of our own planet. We know about the Earth, but we don't know about the sea.
The boatyards of Key West echo with stories of those who never came back. In 1898, Joshua Slocum was the world's most famous sailor. He was the first man to sail solo around the world in his boat, the Spray. Yet in 1909, this man who had defied pirates and hurricanes sailed into the Bermuda Triangle and was never seen again. For years, stories of giant sea monsters, cosmic time warps, spinning compasses, and holes in the ocean that swallowed ships have echoed throughout the world. And the disappearances continue.
I would say there's some kind of a anomaly going on down there that we can't explain. Something that goes on down far, far below the deepest rays, the last rays of sunlight, way down. There's something going on down there.
If Richard Weiner is right, you'd have to be brave or foolish to dive into the Bermuda Triangle. Graham Hawkes, explorer and submersible designer, intends to do just that.
We have all these mysteries in the Bermuda Triangle.
And they exist because here's the surface of the ocean, the light bounces off of that, a ship sinks through that and it's gone. And we don't really know where it's gone. I mean, what we can do with these new tools, the Aviator, is just to peel the lid off of that and go down and look. And guess what? They're all there.
Graham has come to Miami to put his new machine to the test.
One of the things we can do with this sub we're not able to do with conventional ones is to move relatively fast.
Launched from an inflatable cradle, the sub is a revolutionary new design that works like a jet fighter.
Okay, Aquarius, play the game. Let's go.
It is one of the fastest submersibles in the world, and at full speed, it can reach a depth of 150 feet in just 4 seconds. Graham believes that answers to the triangle's myths are down here somewhere.
These wrecks look so ominous in this low visibility, low light.
Down here is also perhaps the answer to the greatest of all Bermuda Triangle mysteries, the strange disappearance of Flight 19. Six months after the end of World War II, Naval Air Station Fort Lauderdale on the east coast of Florida was still busy. The 14 members of Routine Training Flight 19 had just departed on their final qualifying flight over water. In charge was an experienced pilot, Lieutenant Charles Taylor. The flight would take them east to the Bahamas and then back again in just over 2.5 hours. Follows is based entirely on the original radio transcripts.
FT-28 to Barsi. You seem to be taking us off the assigned navigational course.
Over.
Negative, Lieutenant Taylor. According to my compass, I am on the correct course.
Ensign Barsi, we are not on the planned route. I'll assume lead and correct our position. Over.
Roger, Lieutenant.
Five minutes.
We should be seeing land by now. There's nothing out there.
Maybe we're flying too far east.
Fort Lauderdale Tower, this is Fox Terror 28. We seem to be off course. We cannot see land. Repeat, we cannot see land. Can you give us a fix? Over.
Commander Cole to Control Tower.
I got a call on the intercom, or the squawk box, as we used to call them. The control tower called me and said, it looks like, Commander, it looks like we got a flight in trouble.
Roger that. Over.
So what exactly is going on out there?
Sir.
Fox Terror 2-8, this is Fort Lauderdale. What is your current position? Over.
Fort Lauderdale Tower. We are unable to confirm our current position. Over.
FT-28, FT-28, you just need to head due west. Due west. Do you read?
Roger that. We don't know which way is west.
Everything is wrong.
I don't know what they all thought. I know I was very concerned. And getting more concerned as time passed. Because I soon realized that flight was in real trouble.
Years later, the file on Flight 19 is about to be reopened. Phil Giles is one of the UK's leading air accident investigators. Advancements in aviation theory will help him determine what happened, where, and why.
It's fascinating that you can still look at something which happened that long ago and put a new light on it. You can probably read things in the evidence which an inquiry would not read. And to cut into that is quite rewarding.
A few miles south of Fort Lauderdale at Port Everglades Communication Centre, radio man second class Melvin Baker began to pick up signals that a flight was in trouble.
FT-28, this is Fort Lauderdale. Can you now confirm your position?
Fort Lauderdale, this is FT-28. We now have land in sight.
Looks like the winds have blown us over the Florida Keys, but I'm not sure how far down.
And I'm not sure how to get to Fort Lauderdale from my current position. Over.
If you're in the Keys, then put the sun on your port wing and fly north up the coast until you get to Miami. Fort Lauderdale is 20 miles further on.
Roger that.
Can't be over the Keys. The winds are coming from the southwest, which would blow them out over the Atlantic. Will you hand me the mic, please? Thank you. This is Port Everglades, Fox Terror 2-8. How do you read me? Over.
This is Fox Terror 2-8, reading you loud and clear.
This is Baker here, sir. By my reckoning, I don't think you could be over the Keys. Our wind chart suggests you can have been blown in that direction, sir. FT-28, do you read me?
FT-28.
This is Commander Poole, flight officer at Fort Lauderdale. Do you read me?
The personnel in the tower and myself just got pretty quiet because of the hopeless feeling that there was nothing you could do. Tried everything.
Hang on. How much flying time do they have left?
Enough fuel to fly until 2000 hours, Commander.
It gives us 3 hours to get them back.
Flight 19 had been airborne for over 2 hours. According to the original plan, they would have been on the second section of the flight, having turned north over a small island called Cistern Cay. Instead, they were over empty ocean. At this point, nearly 3 hours into the flight, the weather was deteriorating. Taylor had been given all the right directions to get home, but remained unconvinced. the rest of the flight were becoming increasingly concerned.
Taylor, if your compass isn't working, maybe one of us should take the lead.
Negative.
Lieutenant Taylor, sir?
Don't you think that we should go west? My instruments appear to be working.
You want me to take the lead, sir?
Bossy, maintain your position. Over.
At 5:20 p.m., Radio Man Baker began to realize that Flight 19 were closer to home than they thought.
I just turned down the power.
Don't seem to be getting very far.
FT-28, this is Port Everglades. How do you read me? Over.
Port Everglades, this is FT-28. Reading you clearly.
Okay, Lieutenant. I estimate that if you fly southwest, it should bring you toward me. As I turn down the power here, if I can still hear you, it'll mean you are definitely flying toward me.
Roger. We'll go.
He's definitely not over the Gulf. If he was, we wouldn't be able to hear him so clearly. He's gotta be closer.
FT-28 to Port Everglades.
Listen, Baker, if I am that close to you, I should be able to see land.
You might not sight land if you're parallel to us, or... Sir, please, you have enough fuel to reach us. Just keep flying toward me.
Baker! I don't think this is the
right direction.
FT-28 to Fort Lauderdale, do you have a fix yet?
Your transmissions are fading. Repeat, your transmissions are fading. What is your bearing? Over.
FT-28, this is Port Everglades. You have enough fuel to reach us. You read me.
FT-28 to Fort Lauderdale, do you have a fix yet?
I'm turning down the volume, and I can still hear them. They must be flying toward me. Why are they ignoring me?
Taylor.
Maybe we should fly 270 degrees until we hit the beach or run out of gas. Taylor.
Taylor, do you read?
We didn't fly far enough east before we turned. How long have we been going in this direction? Where in the hell are we?
Okay, guys.
When the first man gets down to 10 gallons of gas, we'll all ditch in the water together. Does everyone understand that?
Radio Man Baker was the last one to hear anything.
Foxtair 28, this is Port Everglades. Do you read me? Over.
He knew from their weakening radio signals that they were heading out to sea.
This is Port Everglades, FT-28. Do you read me? Over. Foxtair 28, do you read me? Over.
Nothing was ever heard from them again. The final twist of the mystery that night came when a Martin Mariner rescue plane set out to look for them. 27 minutes later, it too vanished into thin air. Solving the Bermuda Triangle's iconic myth will take all Phil's experience. But there is one mystery that he can clear up immediately.
We don't know which way is west. Everything is wrong.
One thing that Taylor said early on was that his compass has failed. Now, on an aircraft like this, you've got three different compasses. One of them certainly may have failed, but he'd have had two other compasses, and there were 15 compasses in the whole formation. So the failure of the compass is very unlikely.
So compass failure was not the cause. Phil also believes there is a straightforward reason why no trace of the flight was ever found. It may also explain why so many others disappear without a trace. Thank you. The answer lies in Miami. This is the headquarters of the 7th District Miami Coast Guard, the largest and busiest in the world. Phil wants to know how it's possible Flight 19 could have disappeared without a trace. Why no bodies and no wreckage were ever found. Were they looking in the wrong place, or was there something else? Commander Bazzano may have the answers.
So if you take it back to the 1945,
yes.
We had no technology,
right.
Probably 200 miles offshore. You had a rough sea, rain showers, completely overcast.
Very difficult.
Any chance of finding?
Very difficult, yes. Just to give you some perspective, just of today, even if we do our search as perfectly as we possibly can, in the most benign weather conditions, flat seas, no wind, perfect search conditions for the aircraft and crew, our best percentage of finding someone, what we call a probability of detection, is 78%.
The Coast Guard have devised a potentially dangerous exercise in order to demonstrate how difficult it is to find anyone or anything at sea.
Ideal. Pretty much light wind. Seas are probably about 2 feet or less. Excellent visibility.
A second helicopter is about to drop an experienced swimmer in the water. In a few minutes, they'll see if they can find him again.
What we'll do is we'll kind of go out about 200 yards off to the left of him there. And then we'll go up and we'll see how close we have to be to actually find him.
We're going down. Going down.
Those aircraft would have sunk very quickly. Essentially, if you're not looking in the first hour of them being reported lost and having an asset on scene, they're essentially looking for persons in the water.
It's very difficult to see something as small as a person. Think about maybe a soccer ball or a basketball. You're looking basically for something that size, their head sticking out of the water. It's all you can really see. If you don't know exactly where the person is, I don't want to say it's impossible, but it's extremely difficult to find somebody, and especially at night.
The Gulf Stream runs up between Grand Bahama Island and the Florida coast. In some cases, that's a 6-knot current. 6 knots is 6 miles, essentially nautical miles per hour. So every hour, that piece of water that somebody may be stuck on is moving 6 miles every hour. So you can imagine after 12 hours how quickly it moves up. We're talking 80 miles or so already, that it's moved just in 12 hours.
With only 30 minutes of fuel left and the current pulling the swimmer further north every minute, the pressure's on. But at least this time they know roughly where he is.
Got a swimmer inside, I believe, out there at 11 o'clock. Keep your turn in.
Okay.
Keep your turn in. Keep your turn in. Coming up at 12 o'clock, roll out.
You can see how the white cap's breaking right around them. It's really hard to see. You can barely see the man like this, and he's wearing an orange neoprene suit and a big old snorkel on top. And basically, you need to fly right over top of him to be able to see him. At nighttime, it'd be almost impossible, I would say, to see him unless you had an extremely bright moon on flat seas.
Right here.
a successful recovery. But back in 1945, the weather was bad. For 6 days, the largest air-sea rescue since the war searched in vain. Nothing was ever found.
I'm not surprised they disappeared without a trace, because that does happen occasionally here for people that we try to go look for. Sometimes we don't find anybody, even to this day. But if the weather conditions were as bad as described to me, then there'd probably be very little evidence of any kind of debris field or oil slick on the surface of the water, even an hour after the incident took place.
So even today, the chances of finding anyone alive or any evidence of Flight 19 would be slim. But it's still not enough to explain why the flight went so badly wrong. Phil is convinced there is something else.
Okay, low down under the stern, you can just see the props in the gloom.
4 miles out to sea, Graham has found a strange wreck. It's not clear how she got here.
Okay, coming up, take a look at the top of the bow.
Many who know these waters believe they are the most dangerous in the world. But how do they get such a fearsome reputation?
There are still things happening in the Triangle today. We don't hear about them. I would say at least once a week, maybe twice a week, some obscure Bahamian fisherman just never comes back from fishing, just disappeared. It's so commonplace out there that they don't make a big issue of it.
Sailors talk of massive freak waves appearing as if from nowhere and hammering ships into oblivion. Could this bizarre but real phenomenon account for one of the most baffling ship disappearances? The Marine Sulphur Queen, a 500-foot cargo ship, was in good order when she left Texas for Virginia. Early on February the 4th, 1963, she sent a routine radio message from 270 miles west of the Keys. A few hours later, the Sulphur Queen and her 39 crew were never seen again. There is another old mariner's tale that describes the sea literally opening up and swallowing ships. Could there be any truth in this? The first clue emerged in 1985 when cameras captured these extraordinary pictures. An oil platform in the North Sea had punctured a vast gas pocket beneath the seafloor and very nearly sunk. Gas deposits like this exist all around the coastlines of the world, and the Bermuda Triangle is no exception. Trapped in the sediment, the methane gas is highly volatile. An undersea earthquake or landslide could release the gas into the waters above. Could gas bubbles really create a hole in the ocean? Naval physicist Professor Bruce DiNardo has come to Florida to find out.
We have a rough idea. I need to refine the theory, but we have a rough idea what it's going to take to sink that boat. So I'm real excited. I think we're going to be able to do it.
Bruce is going to try and sink this boat in the ocean off this beach in order to see if ships like these can sink in a mass of gas bubbles. Up until now, it's all been theory. The experiment is large scale and will be the first of its kind.
Then it goes to the manifold.
Bruce is going to be helped on the practical side by Hollywood special effects designer Phil Beck. That's about the depth we want to be.
I'm 50-50 on it. I mean, the theory seems like it's right to me, but I don't know. It's a lot of bubbles.
No one has ever attempted an experiment like this before. The aim is to recreate a small-scale methane gas eruption similar to the one that happened in the North Sea. So they are building a large lattice of pipes, which will then be sunk onto the seafloor. They will then pump in a vast amount of air, which behaves like methane, into the lattice. The air will then be forced out of the pipes through small holes into the water above.
My experience in the laboratory is that it takes a lot more bubbles than you might think to sink something. To be honest with you, I don't know what's going to happen here. We'll just have to wait and see.
By mid-afternoon, the divers have lowered the lattice to the seafloor. The plan is to blow a mass of air into the sea above and try and create a hole in the water. With all the pipes connected, they're now ready to start the experiment.
Turn them on.
Yeah!
Very turbulent situation, so the boat's bobbing up and down, but there's a definite loss of buoyancy.
With 25% air in the water, the boat should have sunk. However, there is something they haven't anticipated.
It's not dropping very much. That's not a good sign. The bubbles themselves lower the density and makes it sink, but the upward force due to the flow of the water is keeping the boat up. It looks like the two roughly cancel each other.
There is a neutralizing effect in the center of the bubble field, which means the sinking zone must be just outside the center. Time is running out, and there is only one more thing Bruce can try.
Now, if we get a little bit off center, it's much better. You know, there the flow, it doesn't tend to push the boat up, but out. And you saw the boat, it dropped. The buoyancy clearly reduced there.
See that? Instant drop.
There we go. Is it going?
Yeah, she's going because what's happened is the front's more buoyant than the back.
Looking good.
If you were a 500-foot boat and you're 200-foot would have hit one of these things and your back 300-foot weren't, your boat would just snap in half and sink instantly. What's happening is the front is lifting and the stern is dropping, because the front is in more dense water than the stern. 30 seconds, she's gone.
It's looking real good.
Nope, she's gone.
It's going.
Gone.
That's
she's
it.
Gone. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
They've done it. A gas eruption in the ocean really could sink a boat.
One thing that hits me is how utterly minor what we did compared to what nature can do. You know, we went through all of this trouble to generate bubbles over this small area to sink a little boat. It makes you appreciate a lot more what nature can do.
In the triangle, gas hydrate deposits amount to more than 70 times the gas used by the entire USA in a single year. That's enough to sink a whole fleet of freighters. The chances of being in the wrong place at the wrong time are slim, but possible. So it seems there is truth in the old mariners' tales. Some of the more bizarre disappearances are turning out to have very real explanations. In 1991, Graham Hawkes stumbled onto a mystery himself. At first, he thought he'd found the remains of Flight 19.
We were searching for Spanish galleons. We came across one Avenger on the bottom, thought nothing of it, just lugged it. We came across another aircraft, took a look at it with cameras, an Avenger. Second one, lugged it.
A group of explorers believe they found five American Navy warplanes.
The story hit the headlines. Had they found the mythical Flight 19?
Shocked and surprised. We just didn't expect to find a fifth. It just fit too closely with Flight 19. You know, five aircraft disappeared.
He promised the media an answer within 2 weeks. After studying the grainy images taken by an old camera lowered over the side, the team concluded that these aircraft were probably not from Flight 19. But who were they? The answer would turn out to be just as strange.
That wasn't Flight 19. You mean to tell me there's another five Avengers linked up here? I'd like nice, easy answers. To me, it's much easier that this is the five. Of course it's the five. Of course they went into the sea. Here they are. There's no mystery here. Here they are. No mystery. It's much, much more untidy if it isn't Flight 19 and we have to find out where they are.
Graham Hawks is now going to return to the Phantom 5, and using a new submersible, he's going to go down there himself and find out once and for all who they are. Twelve miles off the coast of Fort Lauderdale, a state-of-the-art scientific research vessel is also going to join the hunt for the lost Avengers.
It's a very big ocean out here, and to find a group of five gaggled together like that, that's the question. What are they doing there? There's something about coming back in person. You find things with remote technology, and it just leaves this itch. This time we have the ceiling submersible, so this time we get to go and almost touch them and smell them, and I think we have a much, much better chance of finding out who they are.
Graham has waited 12 years for this moment.
Good morning.
Good morning. Let's go see some airplanes.
It will take 15 minutes to reach the seabed 734 feet below the ship. In the back of the submersible is Harold Larkin, an expert on Avenger design. The trip is deeply personal to Harold because not only did he fly Avengers, but one of his relatives was on Flight 19 when it disappeared.
Greg, your lines are free and clear. You have permission to dive.
Roger, I got 200 yards, 310. Thank you.
This submersible can take Graham deeper and is perfect for detailed forensic work. The object of the mission is to find each wreck's unique code, called the Bureau number. This is the only way to make a definite identification.
Oh, I love that sound.
Yeah.
Yes.
The sonar signal is getting stronger.
Target's holding up, still there.
We have a contact on sonar.
I'd say the chances of five planes being this close together are about the same as hitting a hole in one and getting struck by lightning while having a winning lottery ticket in your pocket. They would have to go in near each other at about the same speed and the same time, or the currents around here would have spread them apart further than this, even if they were all from the same flight. So whatever happened, happened all at once to these five airplanes.
Oh.
But but there is no record in the Naval Archives of another flight of five Avengers going down at the same time in the same place. The mystery deepens.
Dan, can you give us a status update?
We have a plane in sight. FT-20...
Could be an 8 or a 3.
It looks... yeah.
It's more like a 3. Yeah. Okay, busted off. Tail's gone. Okay, Hal. The fuselage is sheared off just after the trailing edge of the wing.
We may never find it.
The fuselage number, FT-23, means it came out of Fort Lauderdale. But it's not enough to identify the aircraft. When an Avenger was lost, the same number was often reused on its replacement. And with no tail, there's no bureau number. The wing flaps are down, which means the plane ditched. But why may never be known.
Okay. We need to move on. I hate to give up on this.
It seems the Bermuda Triangle doesn't want to give up its secrets so easily. Phil is now ready to investigate why Flight 19 went wrong.
The problem with looking back at something in the past like this is you can never ask that extra question, so you have to deal with the evidence that's available to you. The one thing that isn't covered in any detail is probably one of the most significant causal factors in the flight being lost, and that is the human factors. It wasn't normal in that time to look in any detail into human factors.
Each year, around 30 light aircraft go missing within the triangle. Carol Collins, an experienced instructor, is going to help Phil get into the mindset of a pilot in difficulty in this area.
Okay, we're level at 1,500 feet. When you're flying over an area that has no visual landmarks, it's very easy to lose your sense of motion. For instance, if we started out on a prime heading of east, made a turn to the west as we did, and then turned toward the south, if you're making very gradual turns and you're not being very, very cognizant of what you're doing there, you'll find yourself in a whole other direction than you thought you were.
One of the unique navigational hazards in the Bermuda Triangle is becoming more obvious to Phil from the air.
When you're looking at strings of islands, if there's no houses on them, if there's nothing to identify them, one island can pretty much look like another, as you'll see as we come around and go up here. Right now, we're in good shape because we can look back and we can see, oh, there's the highway. But if we couldn't see that highway, one of these islands would just look so much like another. And in times of poor visibility, that's a serious issue. So getting lost does happen.
We must be over the Southern Gulf.
That's the Gulf, don't you think?
The Gulf, negative. We've gone too far east.
I strongly suggest we fly west until we run out of gas. We have a better chance of being picked up close to shore.
I don't know. We didn't even see the shore.
Just watch the gas, men.
Back on the ground, Phil can now piece together what happened to Flight 19, where and why.
Flight 19 was going to go on Navigation Plan 1, they called it. It was a basic triangle, and it started off at Fort Lauderdale Naval Air Station, and they fly an easterly track from there to these islands here, known as Hen and Chickens, where
they were going to do 20-minute low-level bombing practice. The next leg was onto a track passing over Grand Bahama Island to Great Sail Cay up in the north of the island, and then return to Fort Lauderdale.
So at what point in the training leg do you think they actually went wrong?
Well, I think they went wrong after the bombing run at Hen and Chickens Island.
The winds were stronger than anticipated that day and pushed them northeast from their intended track. They overshot the turn north at Cistern Cay and instead made the turn at Great Abaco Island. If they had been on course, they would have expected to see Grand Bahama Island directly in front of them.
If he had been on track, he would have expected to see land lying across his track, Great Bahamas at right angles. But what he's actually seeing is land paralleling his track. So it may in his mind think, hang on, my compass says north, but the land is to my right. It should be in front of me. Therefore, my compass is reading wrongly. And I think what they've done then is they've carried on until they've come to the northern part of this island. Then they've seen this small run of islands going up here in a northwesterly direction. They've followed that when they're saying, we think we're over the Keys.
Looks like the winds have blown us over the Florida Keys,
but I'm not sure how far down. I don't know how to get to Fort Lauderdale from our current position, over.
It was at this point that Commander Poole had become concerned. Taylor was flying over a small string of islands north of Great Abaco. He mistook them for the similar-looking islands of the Florida Keys, over 200 miles away. This extraordinary error means Taylor thought he was over the Gulf of Mexico on the opposite side of Florida.
So all the headings he flies thereafter are taken on the premise that he is over here in the Gulf of Mexico rather than over here in the North Atlantic. So they are virtually the opposite, directly opposite to the headings that you would need to fly.
So he's actually trying to get back to mainland Florida and flying himself further out to sea in
yes,
the Atlantic Ocean.
That is it. Simply, he's heading for the wrong part of the coast.
I can't see nothing in this.
Taylor, are you okay?
When the first man gets down to 10 gallons of gas, we'll all land in the water together. Everyone check their main west.
We're out of gas. We're going down. Going down.
At 734 feet down, Graham Hawks has found the fifth and final wreck.
Oh, there we go.
We got it.
Will this ghostly Avenger be able to tell them its story?
FT-87. Okay, well, the good news is the canopy is back, which means the four crooks probably got out there. Can we go and take a good look at the tail section?
Yeah.
See if we can find anything there.
The wreck is in good condition, but like the others, it's missing its tail fin. They're beginning to think the Phantom Five don't want to be identified.
We want to show you something, Howard. I think this may be the vertical rudder.
Well, I could turn sideways.
Right in front of us now.
Where?
And underneath, there's a little wing coming in the section into view now. Your left wing.
In the middle of what?
Right in the middle of the screen.
Right.
I can see something out of the porthole.
Holy cow.
Yeah, there, then we should get a bureau number.
It's the difference between human eyes and a camera.
At last, NAV 23990. This is the bureau number. Unique to each aircraft, it will tell Graham how it came to be here. With their mission accomplished, they head back to the surface. While Florida celebrates the 4th of July, Graham is already stuck into the naval accident reports. It's the moment he's waited for 12 years. NAV 23990, lost at sea. On the 9th October 1943, FT-87, piloted by Ensign George Swint, was returning to Fort Lauderdale from a bombing run. On board were Airman Second Class Sam Trees and Jay Lewellis. At precisely 12:20 p.m., the engine suffered a catastrophic loss of fuel and ditched. Swint and his crew survived. FT-87, lost for 60 years. Graham now knows how she got here. Of the remaining four wrecks, one is missing its whole tail section. And there is only one accident report from August 1944 showing a fatal mid-air collision where the tail was destroyed. Could this be the final resting place of pilot John Barry and Airmen Third Class Joe Marcotte and Fred Burns? For Graham, it's the scenario he least expected. Despite the odds, they are just a random collection of accidents that came to rest in the same place, 12 miles from home. Based on the information before him, Phil can make an accurate guess at where Flight 19 ditched.
The various HFDF stations produced a very good fix at 10 minutes to 6. And as you can see, it's up in the North Atlantic, about 100 miles off Daytona Beach, nowhere near the Gulf of Mexico.
But by the time the tower received the fix, Flight 19 was already out of range. Ironically, that fix put them only 25 minutes from Daytona Beach. At that stage, they were still going west, towards home. At 7:15, they were overheard discussing turning east. At 7:45, they would have had enough fuel to continue for another 15 minutes, which means they probably ditched here, about 220 miles east of Daytona Beach. We now know what happened to the flight. The question is, why did an experienced pilot like Taylor not realize this gross error? What was going on in his mind?
He established a mindset fairly early on after he had realized he wasn't on the correct track that he was in the Keys at Florida.
Phil has concluded that as conditions deteriorated, Taylor suffered a serious mental breakdown, a kind of tunnel vision that made him blind to any of the options he was offered.
I don't think you can be over the Keys. Our wind chart suggests you can have been blown in that direction.
Today, this condition is known as spatial disorientation. It is considered to be one of the most dangerous threats to any pilot.
There was no shaking it. And this is not an unusual phenomenon. People decide on something, and then with the stress of the occasion, they will stick with that initial concept because in their mind, it's very real. Once he'd got this mindset, it was going to stay with him until forever, because no one was going to jog him out of it.
This would explain why Taylor insisted his compass wasn't working.
We don't know which way is west. Everything is wrong.
But what about the rescue plane that also disappeared? Martin mariners were known as flying gas tanks. Several had exploded in midair due to a spark or even a crewman's cigarette. A few days into the search, a report from a ship in the area claimed an explosion had been seen in the sky at the same time as the mariner vanished.
Right, men. It's 2000 hours.
I felt hopeless because there's nothing more you can do. The worst night I ever had in my life.
After 60 years, what happened to Flight 19 is now clear. And like so many mysteries, there is always a rational explanation available, if you choose to believe it.
People love a mystery. They want a mystery. No matter what it is, they want their mystery.
Which is why the Bermuda Triangle will remain the most romantic of the ocean's great myths.
Coming up next here this evening on BBC4, sleeping bag, bed socks, toothbrush. Yep, I'm ready for a sleepover at the zoo to find out what the animals get up to after dark.